Good afternoon to everyone and welcome to today's session. I hope today's test had been cerebrally sumptuous, and there are 2 to 3 errors which we will correct during discussion. Now, a $1 million question, I know what is there in your mind. First of all, is there any pregnancy or not? We will decide about cesarean or what kind of delivery later. But pehla ye to batao sir, hoga ya nahi hoga? So yesterday when I woke up, when I opened the newspaper, I was also dazed like you. Then I thought, first we started with image based questions of 180 question paper. We had been torturing the students with all sorts of weird images, assertion reason questions. Then after that, suddenly there is an unexpected pregnancy, November 23rd. Then we immediately ran and started 240 pattern. Now once more Supreme Court says that all Indians are one, except from the AP and JK. You are not just the brothers and sisters, you are the big brothers, so you will get an exception. So suddenly this reminds me, unfortunately, one story. In the Hindu tradition of cremation, when the father is taken to the cremation, while going to the burial ghat, they will bring down the dead body 2 to 3 times. The son will go and tell in the ears of the father, "Father, I am your son. Is there any chance that you will wake up? You will wake up and you will wake up." 3 times it will be told before taking to the burial ghat. The main idea is the dead body will be very heavy. So middle mein ek baar zameen par nikal diye to, it will be a small interruption for the fellows who are carrying the dead body. So like that, before November 23rd, 3 times dead body will be brought down and it will be told, "Are you still alive? Are you still alive? Supreme Court is saying that there is a possibility that you can be alive." So the dead body did not wake up and finally cremated. So doctor, let us keep our fingers crossed. After all, NEET PG is nothing but an AP PG with another 60 questions extra. And a little prolonged presentation of NAD Physio Biochem Micro Pharma Patho. That's all. By 29th, once we get a clear picture, we can be able to shift back to our age-old tradition of APPG pattern of question paper along with the NEET PG, because a lot of North Indian students and non-AP students are still with us. So that's the reason we will combine the two kind of both the kind of question paper will be available. But till then, keep preparing. Don't lose time, because actually we are also in a very vulnerable position. Chance dar mile to reading room ko chhod ke kuch let us enjoy kind of a mood. And this kind of a news is altogether an alibi for us to give up reading. Let's not do that. Okay, so let us continue our discussion. We welcome our online students everywhere from Vizag, Tirupati, Karnool, Kakinada, etc., etc. Posterior columns, typically, can you increase the volume? I hope the voice is clear. Posterior columns, typically, the cell bodies are pseudo unipolar on the dorsal column, is what you need to fundamentally remember. Now, coming to the various nerves, can you raise the voice? Coming to the nerve which passes through the spiral groove, which is the nerve, doctor, that we are talking about? Radial nerve. Radial nerve also supplies the supinator of the forearm. Tell me, doctor, What is the supination of the forearm when our elbow is extended? When the elbow is extended, it is supinator muscle, which is supplied by radial nerve. But you flex your elbow and try to supinate, then your biceps brachii typically becomes very prominent. So that is the reason during the flexion, it is the biceps brachii with musculocutaneous nerve, and extension, it is the radial nerve and the supinator muscle is what you have to fundamentally remember. Now, coming to the triceps, it is definitely supplied by the radial nerve, but the branch to the triceps is given by the radial nerve before it enters the spiral groove. That is the fix about this question. There will be no paralysis of the triceps, is what I want to underscore to all of you. Now, coming to the dorsiflexion and eversion, many times we discussed, it is the posterior tibial nerve, branch of the common peroneal nerve, which can get injured, typically when there is any blow on to the head of the fibula, and the fracture of the head of the fibula is what you have to ultimately remember. What is deep petrosal nerve? The deep petrosal nerve merges with the greater petrosal nerve, and it is the one which basically contains the postganglionic sympathetic fibers, not preganglionic, is what you are going to remember. Now, there is a surprising thing about our head. What is that? The sympathetic innervation of the head does not originate in the head. Of course, it originates in the head, it descends down into the neck and once more comes back and innervates our head. So our head listens the word of our neck, ultimately, is what need to remember. It is T1 to L2, which typically contains the preganglionic sympathetic fibers, is what I want to underscore to all of you. VPL, VPM, the nuclei, you have to be very clear, doctor. The VPM nucleus in the thalamus, it is the vestibular efferents which are concerned with the equilibrium, the synapse in the VPM nucleus, not VPL, is what need to be remembered. Okay, doc, let me wake you up from the sleep. There are two kinds of bias. Suppose if the researcher believes, I am asking a question, you need to give me an answer. The researcher believes that the efficacy of the treatment is going to change the outcome of the study, then that can lead to the development of the bias. Similarly, when a group is being studied, there can be a change in the behavior of the group. For example, you are studying the influence of alcohol and the risk of heart attack. Suddenly people studied in the internet everywhere that drinking leads to heart attack and they stopped drinking. They are in the drinker group, but the frequency of drinking they decreased. That means they know the effect of drinking and changed their behavior, and that can ultimately affect your study results. Which kind of bias is called Pygmalion effect in the biostatistics is the question. Who will give me the correct answer? The first one or second one? Which is called first one? That is when a researcher believes in the efficacy of the treatment, it changes the outcome. Dr. Dilip says second is called Pygmalion. Even Dr. Shankar from Bangalore says it is the second, which is the Pygmalion. Nobody want to say first. First is Pygmalion. Second is called as Hawthorne's effect. It's called as Hawthorne's effect is what need to be remembered. Now, are we suffering from Pygmalion effect or Hawthorne effect when it comes to NEET PG? We believe that the efficacy of our performance depends upon the style of the examination, online or offline. So that is the reason definitely we suffer from a Pygmalion effect. Hawthorne is, we think that by studying little more until March, we may get better rank. But everybody will read until March better and probably we may get a poorer rank. So the Hawthorne bias is much more dangerous. Now, coming to the inferior olivary nucleus. Let's talk about the cerebellum, doctor. Typically, all the cerebellar afferents will be referred to as mossy fibers, except those which come from the inferior olivary nucleus. Where is the inferior olivary nucleus located? In the medulla. See, medulla communicates with cerebellum through inferior cerebellar peduncle. Midbrain communicates through superior cerebellar peduncle. Pons communicates through middle cerebellar peduncle. So that inferior olivary nucleus in the medulla communicates to the inferior cerebellar peduncle, and those fibers which come from the inferior cerebellar peduncle and from the inferior olivary nucleus are basically called as climbing fibers. And all the other afferents which come to the cerebellum, afferents, are called as mossy fibers. This is a small speck of cerebellar anatomy, histoanatomy. So I don't want to go too deep into it, but yes, cerebellum is an important issue for the examiner when it comes to neuroanatomy. Now, coming to the cerebellum, it does not receive any contralateral fibers typically. It won't have any such contralateral innervation coming. Now, if there is a pure cerebellar lesion, how do you recognize it? Intention tremor, unsteady, wide-based gait. How many of you answered it as sensory ataxia? I know. Sensory ataxia means if your dorsal columns are not working, doctor, then what will happen? Normally, you will walk without difficulty. Why? Your eyes are able to see the ground. But the moment you are asked to walk closing the eyes, you will start swaying and falling down. That is an example of dorsal column involvement is called sensory ataxia, which can occur in those who are having the vitamin B12 deficiency. And when they walk to the wash basin, whenever they happen to wash the face, then that can lead to the development of fainting episode. I think our Warangal requirement UPS, we will try to put it. We were almost in the process of winding up a lot of centers because November 15th the show is over. But suddenly once more they are saying since AP state entrance is there, we need to once more restart all our centers because till March we need to run the show. So we will definitely improve it. Now coming to the carotid sheath. Internal carotid is most medial, internal jugular is lateral, and comes the vagus. That is a typical anatomical arrangement in the carotid sheath is what need to be fundamentally remembered.